Chapter 18. The Back Room.
My greetings, faceless one, the High Priestess said, pushing past Alton into his private chambers in Sorcerer. And mine to you, Mistress Vierna, Alton replied, trying to keep the fear out of his voice. Vierna Doerden coming to see him at this time had to be more than a coincidence. What act has brought me the honor of a visit from the Mistress of Arachtinolith? No longer a mistress, said Vierna. I have returned to my home. Alton paused to consider the news. He knew that Dinan Doerden had also resigned his position at the academy. Matron Malice has brought her family back together, Vierna continued. There are stirrings of war. You have heard them, no doubt. Just rumors, Alton stuttered, now beginning to understand why Vierna had come to call on him. House Doerden had used the Faceless One before in its plotting, in its attempt to assassinate Alton. Now, with rumors of war whispered throughout Menzo Baranzon, Matron Malice was re-establishing her network of spies and assassins.
You know of them? Vierna asked sharply.
I have heard little, Alton breathed, careful now not to anger the powerful female. Not enough to report to your house. I did not even suspect that House Doerden was involved until now, when you informed me.
Alton could only hope that Vierna had no detection spell aimed at his words. Vierna relaxed, apparently appeased by his explanation.
Listen more carefully to the rumors, Faceless One, she said. My brother and I have left the academy. You are to be the eyes and ears of House Doerden in this place.
But,
Alton stuttered. Vierna held up a hand to stop him.
We know of our failure in our last transaction, she said.
She bowed low, something a High Priestess rarely did to a male.
Matron Malice sends her deepest apologies that the unguent you received for the assassination of Alton DeVere did not restore the features to your face.
Alton nearly choked on his words, now understanding why an unknown messenger had delivered the jar of healing salve some 30 years before. The cloaked figure was an agent of House Doerden, come to repay the Faceless One for his assassination of Alton. Of course, Alton had never even tried the unguent. With his luck, it would have worked, and would have restored the features of Alton DeVere.
This time your payment cannot fail, Vierna went on,
though Alton too caught up in the irony of it all, hardly listened.
House Doerden possesses a wizard's staff, but no wizard worthy to wield it. It belonged to Nalfane, my brother, who died in the victory over DeVere.
Alton wanted to strike out at her. Even he wasn't that stupid, though.
If you can discern which house plots against House Doerden, Vierna promised, the staff will be yours. A treasure indeed for such a small act. I will do what I can, Alton replied,
having no other response to the incredible offer.
That is all Matron Malice asks of you, said Vierna.
And she left the wizard, quite certain that House Doerden had secured a capable agent within the academy.
Dinan and Vierna Doerden have resigned their positions, said Alton excitedly as the diminutive matron mother came to him later that same evening. This is already known to me, replied Cynefae Hanet.
She looked around disdainfully at the littered and scorched room, then took a seat at the small table.
There is more,
Alton said quickly, not wanting Cynefae to get upset about being disturbed over old news.
I have had a visitor this day, Mistress Vierna Doerden. She suspects?
Matron Cynefae growled.
No, no, Alton replied. Quite the opposite. House Doerden wishes to employ me as a spy, as it once employed the Faceless One to assassinate me.
Cynefae paused for a moment, stunned, then issued a laugh straight from her belly.
The ironies of our lives, she roared. I had heard that Dinan and Vierna were sent to the academy only to oversee the education of their younger brother, remarked Alton. An excellent cover, Cynefae replied. Vierna and Dinan were sent in as spies for the ambitious Matron Malice. My compliments to her. Now they suspect trouble,
Alton stated, sitting opposite his matron mother.
They do, agreed Cynefae. Maso patrols with Drist, but House Doerden has also managed to plant Dinan in the group.
Then Maso is in danger, reasoned Alton.
No, said Cynefae. House Doerden does not know that House Hanet perpetrates the threat against it, else it would not have come to you for information. Matron Malice knows your identity.
A look of terror crossed Alton's face.
Not your true identity,
Cynefae laughed at him.
She knows the Faceless One as Gelruz Hanet, and she would not have come to Hanet if she suspected our house.
Then we have an excellent opportunity to throw House Doerden into chaos, Alton cried. If I implicate another house, even Benray perhaps, our position will be strengthened,
he chuckled at the possibilities.
Malice will reward me with a staff of great power, a weapon I will turn against her at the proper moment.
Matron Malice, Cynife corrected sternly.
Even though she and Malice were soon to be open enemies, Cynife would not permit a male to show such disrespect to a matron mother.
Do you really believe that you could carry out such a deception?
When Mistress Vianek returns,
you will not deal with a lesser priestess with such valued information, foolish Devere. You will face Matron Malice herself, a formidable foe. If she sees through your lies, do you know what she will do to your body?
Alton gulped audibly.
I am willing to take the risk, he said, crossing his arms resolutely on the table.
What of House Hanette, when the biggest lie is revealed? Cynife asked. What advantage will we enjoy when Matron Malice knows of the Faceless One's true identity?
I understand, Alton answered, crestfallen but unable to refute Cynife's logic.
Then what are we to do? What am I to do?
Matron Cynife was already considering their next moves.
You will resign your tenure, she said at length. Return to House Hanette within my protection.
Such an act might also implicate House Hanette to Matron Malice, Alton reasoned.
It may, replied Cynife, but it is the safest route. I will go to Matron Malice in feigned anger, telling her to leave House Hanette out of her troubles. If she wishes to make an informant of a member of my family, then she should come to me for permission, though I'll not grant it this time.
Cynife smiled at the possibilities of such an encounter.
My anger, my fear alone, could implicate a greater house against House de Werden. Even a conspiracy between more than one house, she said, obviously enjoying the added benefits. Matron Malice will certainly have much to think about and much to worry about.
Alton hadn't even heard Cynife's last comments. The words about granting her permission, this time, had brought a disturbing notion into his mind.
And did she?
He dared to ask, though his words were barely audible.
What do you mean?
Asked Cynife, not following his thoughts.
Did Matron Malice come to you?
Alton continued, frightened but needing an answer.
30 years ago, did Matron Cynife grant her permission for Gelruz Hanette to become an agent, an assassin, to complete House de Vere's elimination?
A wide smile spread across Cinefe's face, but it vanished in the blink of an eye as she threw the table across the room, grabbed Alton by the front of his robes, and pulled him roughly to within an inch of her scowling visage.
Never confuse personal feelings with politics,
the tiny but obviously strong matron growled, her tone carrying the unmistakable weight of an open threat.
And never ask me such a question again.
She threw Alton to the floor, but didn't release him from her penetrating glare. Alton had known all along that he was merely a pawn in the intrigue between House Hanette and House de Werden, a necessary link for Matron Cynife to carry out her treacherous plans. Every now and then, though, Alton's personal grudge against House de Werden caused him to forget his lowly place in this conflict. Looking up now at Cinefe's bared power, he realized that he had overstepped the bounds of his position. At the back end of the mushroom grove, the southern wall of the cavern that housed Menzo Baranzon, was a small, heavily guarded cave. Beyond the iron-bound doors stood a single room, used only for gatherings of the city's 8 ruling matron mothers. The smoke of 100 sweet-smelling candles permeated the air. The matron mothers liked it that way. After almost half a century of studying scrolls in the candlelight of Sorcerer, Alton did not mind the light, but he was indeed uncomfortable in the chamber. He sat at the back end of the spider-shaped table, in a small, unadorned chair reserved for guests of this council. Between the table's 8 hairy legs were the ruling matron mother's thrones, all jeweled and dazzling in the candlelight. The matrons filed in, pompous and wicked, casting belittling glares at the male. Cynife, at Alton's side, put a hand on his knee and gave him a reassuring wink. She would not have dared to request a gathering of the ruling council if she was not certain of the worthiness of her news. The ruling matron mothers viewed their seats as honorary in nature and did not appreciate being brought together except in times of crisis. At the head of the spider table sat Matron Benray, the most powerful figure in all of Menzo Baranzon, an ancient and withered female with malicious eyes and a mouth unaccustomed to smiles.
We are gathered, Cynife,
Benray said when all 8 members had found their appointed chairs.
For what reason have you summoned the council?
To discuss a punishment, Cynife replied.
Punishment?
Matron Benray echoed, confused. The recent years had been unusually quiet in the Drow City, without an incident since the Tekendis Freth conflict. To the first matron's knowledge, no acts had been committed that might require a punishment. certainly none so blatant as to force the ruling council to action.
What individual deserves this?
Not an individual,
explained Matron Cinefe. She glanced around at her peers, measuring their interest.
A house,
she said bluntly.
Dermon Neshez Bernon, House Doerden.
Several gasps of disbelief came in reply, as Cinefe had expected.
House Doerden,
Matron Benray questioned, surprised that any would implicate Matron Malice. By all of Benray's knowledge, Malice remained in high regard with the Spider Queen, and House Doerden had recently placed two instructors in the academy.
For what crime do you dare to charge House Doerden? Asked one of the other matrons. Are these words of fear, Cinefe?
Matron Benray had to ask. Several of the ruling matrons had expressed concerns about House Doerden. It was well known that Matron Malice desired a seat on the ruling council, and by all measures of the power of her house, she seemed destined to get it.
I have appropriate cause, Cinefe insisted. The others seem to doubt you, replied Matron Benray. You should explain your accusation, quickly, if you value your reputation.
Cinefe knew that more than her reputation was at stake, and Menzo Berenzon, a false accusation, was a crime on par with murder.
We all remember the fall of House de Vere, Cinefe began. Seven of us now gathered sat upon the ruling council beside Matron Cinefe de Vere. House de Vere is no more, Matron Benray reminded her.
Because of House Doerden, Cinefe said bluntly.
This time the gasp came out as open anger.
How dare you speak such words, came one reply. 30 years, came another. The issue has been forgotten.
Matron Benray quieted them all before the clamor rose into violent action, a not uncommon occurrence in the council chamber.
Cinefe,
she said through the dry sneer of her lips.
One cannot make such an accusation. One cannot discuss such beliefs openly so long after the event. You know our ways. If House Doerden did indeed commit this act, as you insist, it deserves our compliments, not our punishment, for it carried it through to perfection. House de Vere's no more. I say, it does not exist.
Alton shifted uneasily, caught somewhere between rage and despair. Cinefe was far from dismayed, though. This was going exactly as she had envisioned and hoped.
Oh, but it does,
she responded, rising to her feet. She pulled the hood from Alton's head.
In this person. Gelruse?
Asked Matron Benray, not understanding.
Not Gelruse, Cinefe replied. Gelruse Hanet died the night House de Vere died. This male, Alton de Vere, assumed Gelruse's identity and position, hiding from further attacks by House Doerden.
Benray whispered some instructions to the matron at her right side, then waited as she went through the semantics of a spell. Benray motioned for Cinefe to return to her seat, then faced Alton.
Speak your name, Benray commanded.
I am Alton de Vere,
Alton said, gaining strength from the identity he had waited so very long to proclaim.
Son of Matron Cinefe and a student of Sorcerer on the night House Doerden attacked.
Benray looked to the matron at her side.
He speaks the truth,
the matron assured her. Whispers sprang up all around the spider table, of amusement more than anything else.
That is why I summoned the ruling council,
Cinefe quickly explained.
Very well, Cinefe, said Matron Benray. My compliments to you, Alton de Vere, on your resourcefulness and ability to survive. For a male, you have shown great courage and wisdom. Surely you both know that the council cannot exact punishment upon a house for a deed committed so long ago. Why would we so desire? Matron Malice Doerden sits in the favor of the Spider Queen. Her house shows great promise. You must reveal to us greater need if you wish any punishment against House Doerden.
I do not wish such a thing, Cinefe quickly replied. This matter 30 years removed is no longer in the realm of the ruling council. House Doerden does indeed show promise, my peers. With 4 high priestesses and a host of other weapons, not the least of which being their second boy, Drist, first graduate of his class.
She had purposely mentioned Drist, knowing that the name would strike a wound in Matron Benray. Benray's own prized son, Bergignon, had spent the last 9 years ranked behind the wonderful young Doerden.
Then why have you bothered us?
Matron Benray demanded, an unmistakable edge in her voice.
To ask you to close your eyes, Cinefe purred. Alton is a Hanet now, under my protection. He demands vengeance for the act committed against his family, and as a surviving member of the attacked family, he has the right of accusation. House Hanet will stand beside him? Matron Benray asked, turning curious and amused. Indeed, replied Sinife. Thus is House Hanet bound.
Vengeance? Another matron quipped, also now more amused than angered.
Or fear. It would seem to my ears that the matron of House Hanet uses this pitiful Devere creature for her own gain. House de Warden aspires to higher rankings, and Matron Malice desires to sit upon the ruling council. A threat to House Hanet, perhaps? Be it vengeance or prudence, my claim, Alton Devere's claim, must be deemed as legitimate, replied Sinife. To our mutual gain, she smiled wickedly and looked straight to the first matron. To the gain of our sons, perhaps, in their quest for recognition.
Indeed, replied Matron Benray, in a chuckle that sounded more like a cough.
A war between Hanet and Doherden might be to everyone's gain, but not, Benray suspected, as Sinife believed. Malice was a powerful matron, and her family truly deserved a ranking higher than ninth. If the fight did come, Malice probably would get her seat on the council, replacing Sinife. Matron Benray looked around at the other matrons and guessed from their hopeful expressions that they shared her thoughts. Let Hanet and Doherden fight it out. Whatever the outcome, the threat of Matron Malice would be ended. Perhaps, Benray hoped, a certain young Doherden male would fall in battle, propelling her own son into the position he deserved. Then the first matron spoke the words Sinife had come to hear, the silent permission of Menzo Berenzin's ruling council.
This matter is settled, my sisters, Matron Benray declared to the accepting nods of all at the table. It is good that we never met this day.